we are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Good morning, I'm Vivian Gulia. Here are the latest headlines this hour. Advisors to the U.S. Food and Drug Administration recommend booster shots to senior citizens and high-risk individuals. Philippine senators blow the lid on where officials of Farmaly Pharmaceuticals spent the millions they earned from controversial deals with the government. And the U.S. military apologizes after it reveals 10 people were killed, including 7 children, during its drone strike in Kabul last month. Americans 65 years and older and those at high risk of severe illness should be given booster shots. That's a recommendation of a panel of expert advisors to the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. The panel also recommended that the FDA include healthcare workers and others at risk of occupational exposure, such as teachers. Friday's vote, if followed by the FDA, would be a more modest rollout of booster shots that outlined by the Biden administration. But the panel members rejected a call for broader approval for a third dose. It also rejected Pfizer's request for full approval for booster shots for those aged 16 years and older. Over in China, a study showed that a third shot of Sinopharm's COVID-19 vaccine leads to a rebound in antibody levels. It also showed that the booster enhanced cell-based responses to the coronavirus. Based on an analysis of samples from healthcare workers, the average concentration of neutralizing antibody against the virus dropped by 70%, 5 months after the second Sinopharm dose. But 1 week after the third shot, the antibody concentration increased to more than sevenfold. The findings, yet to be peer-reviewed, come as China starts to give a third shot to higher-risk members of the population. Here at home, senators discover how controversial firm Farmaly Pharmaceuticals used its windfall from its allegedly overpriced deals with the government. Katrina Domingo with the full story.
Senators questioned how Farmaly Pharmaceutical Corporation was able to donate some 33 million pesos in goods to several government offices and hospitals when the amount accounts for 79% of the company's operating expenses.
Is that unusual that 78% of your operations goes to a donation?
79%, Mr. Chairman. Yes po, Mr. Chairman. Normally po nasa salaries po at rent expense ang malaking portion po ng operating expenses.
When Senate Minority Leader Franklin Drilon asked for the company's deeds of donation, formerly accountant Iluminada Sebial says she was only given a list of beneficiaries. Formally did not mention what supplies it donated to several government entities, but Sebial's list of recipients include 2 hospitals and 5 local government units in Luzon.
Meron pa po yata po sila, pero hindi po nila naisabing sa akin ng mga papel. Listahan lang po yung binigay po nila.
In a Facebook post, November last year, the Quezon City government showed pictures of medical supplies donated by Formally. San Juan City Mayor Francis Zamora made a similar post about Formally's donations, also November last year. Formally officials could not immediately answer queries about their hefty donations, which prompted the Senate panel to subpoena the firm's financial documents and hire its own forensic auditor to check the company's compliance with the law. Senate Blue Ribbon Committee Chairman Richard Gordon also questioned how 3 Formally executives were able to acquire at least 4 luxury vehicles less than a year after their company bagged its first deal with the Department of Budget and Management's Procurement Service, or PSDBM.
Paano mo papaliwanag yan? December 7, 2020. From April, nakumita kayo. From May and June, kumita kayo. Biglang may 13 million si Twinkle Dargani. Talagang nagpapasasa talaga itong mga taong ito.
Senator Risa Ontiveros also flagged how Formally seems to have been accustomed to delivering millions of face masks to the PSDBM, even if the agency has yet to issue an official purchase order.
Sabi niyo sa kanya, sige, we'll email docs now. Also, are you aware na nag-deliver kami last week ng 2 million pieces? Ha ha. Ang sagot niya, wait, 2 million? Ha ha ha. Akala ko 900,000 lang stock nyo. Advance delivery ba ito? Sagot nyo naman mismo, go, yes, advance. Aha. Sabi nung ka-text nyo, yikes, aha, sino nag-utos? At ang sagot nyo mismo ay, ask ko muna sila boss. Aha, di ko rin ako aware eh.
I do have to check the text messages po kasi this happened over a year ago and with all that happened last year and this year, medyo hindi po siya fresh sa aking memory. So please allow me some time to confirm po.
Health Secretary Francisco Duque III appeared at the hearing. He was allowed by President Rodrigo Duterte to do so. Duterte defended the health department's decision to procure RT-PCR test kits from Formally that were about to expire in 6 months, even if the official specs from the agency required kits with a 12 to 24-month shelf life.
The situation was really dire. The supply was scarce, if almost none, very few. Demand was really acute and overwhelming. And so it was very difficult to finally say that, oh, ito lang yung presyo, ha?
But Senator Francis Pangilinan argued that the PSDBM still priced the test kits based on its retail price, when the government could have gotten a huge discount since it was buying in bulk. With more questions than answers, the Senate panel decided to suspend the hearing and resume next week when Formally's financial records and disclosures are submitted to the chamber. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
After President Rodrigo Duterte described him as a meal for a blood-sucking vampire, Senator Richard Gordon bears fangs of his own and bites back. Katrina Domingo returns with this report.
Senator Richard Gordon launches his own verbal tirade against President Rodrigo Duterte at the resumption of the Blue Ribbon Committee's investigation on government's procurement of pandemic supplies. He castigated the chief executive for defending officials allegedly involved in the supposedly anomalous transactions.
Mahirap kayong tanggilikin, Mr. President, because you do not act like a president. Today, I tell you, you are not a president the Filipino people can respect. No country deserves that kind of leadership. No country deserves your leadership.
Duterte has been relentless in attacking Gordon during his public addresses, fat-shaming the senator and calling him a despot for leading a Senate investigation that linked former presidential economic adviser Michael Yang and former budget undersecretary Lloyd Christopher Lau to questionable transactions within the budget department's procurement service. Gordon shrugged off these insults, saying he pities the president who supposedly failed to gain the respect of world leaders.
Nobody talks to you in international conferences because nauna yung reputation nyo na mapagmura, mapusok, at talagang sinasabi nyo, kill, kill, kill. I am really sorry for you, Mr. President. Ang pinagtatanggal nyo, si Lau, may utang na loob kayo dahil sa eleksyon. You are a cheap politician.
Gordon also denies Duterte's accusation he has been using congressional investigations to gain traction in the run-up to the 2022 national elections. Duterte said he would actively campaign against the senator. Gordon earlier said he would either run for president, senator, or mayor of his hometown, Olongapo. But on Friday...
Alam mo, hindi na ako tatakbo, sa totoo lang eh. Ayoko na eh. Wala akong plano ngayon.
Minority senators lauded Gordon for his strong words against the president.
My admiration and my congratulations to Senator Gordon for the courage that he has shown. Mabuhay ka niya.
We thank you, Senator Gordon, chairman of the committee, for your courage. And we thank you for your zeal in addressing the what I call massive corruption.
Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
The effectiveness of the new quarantine system being tested in Metro Manila will be assessed on a weekly basis. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere says they will try to determine which measures are not effective so these can be modified.
Every week we will be assessing so that we will see yung progress natin, ano yung pwedeng baguhin, ano yung pwede na nating i-retain, ano yung mga metrics na dapat pag-aralan, at ano pa yung ways moving forward.
Over 50 areas in Metro Manila are under granular lockdowns. Vergere says the system will be fine-tuned before it's implemented across the country. The Philippine Health Department says Metro Manila's COVID-19 cases could reach over 40,000 daily by the end of the month. But some health experts warn the country's COVID-19 figures do not actually reflect the real situation on the ground. Rafael Bosano reports.
16,000 to 43,000. This is what the Health Department projects in terms of daily cases in the capital region by the end of September. Their projections are hinged on mobility, healthcare capacity, and the public's adherence to minimum health standards.
Kapag ka atin pong na-improve itong mga nakalagay na factors sa assumptions, we might not reach these numbers no, na sinasabi natin. Katulad nung nangyari dito sa NCR nung end of August, nagkaroon ng projection that we will reach about 80 plus thousand active cases by the end of August. Hopefully, with what we are doing right now with this pilot implementation, we will not reach this kind of projections.
Professor Guido David of the Octo Research Group, for his part, believes the daily cases will no longer reach the 30,000 mark.
Kumbaga sa bundok, umakyat tayo ng bundok, and nakalagpas na tayo sa part na talagang steep. Uh-oh. Yung paakit natin. So ngayon, medyo parang walking na lang tayo, halos patag na. We're hoping andyan na, malapit na, makikita na natin, ayan na yung peak, maglalagay tayo ng flag, tapos pababa na tayo, parang gano'n.
The alert levels and granular lockdowns in the National Capital Region are based on healthcare capacity and the number of cases. But in a statement, Healthcare Professionals Alliance Against COVID-19 believes these figures do not reflect what's really happening on the ground. This is why they encourage the government to find solutions to the inadequacies in data reporting systems on which alert levels are based. These include data from emergency rooms or ERs that aren't part of data on ward bed and ICU utilization rates. The ER is the first place where patients with COVID-19 would usually go when they need urgent medical care. But health spokesperson Maria Rosario Vergere says they have long taken note of data from ERs but are having difficulties in setting standards.
Pag tinignan po natin yung dati nilang capacity, hindi na po yan ang capacity nila. Meron na rin po tayo mga emergency room set up sa labas na naka-tent na lang po, may mga triage areas. At ito po ay atin pong pinag-aaralan maigi kung paano tayo makakapag-send, set ng standard metric so that we can be able to measure and analyze ito pong emergency room occupancy in all of our hospitals.
The DOH also flagged the inappropriate use of antigen tests by some local governments.
Some of the local governments use this for screening employees, screening those who are going to pictorials, screening those who are going to weddings. So hindi po yan appropriate use ng antigen test. Kaya hindi po natin pwedeng tanggapin because this might lead to inaccurate reports of positive cases.
Daily case reports released by the DOH do not include those testing positive for antigen tests. Verheri explains in their latest run, out of the 10,000 positive tests submitted, only 3,000 were found to actually be valid. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
A morgue in Lucena City overwhelmed by the high number of COVID-19 deaths. Dennis Dato gives us a look in this report.
A cellphone video obtained by ABS-CBN News from a source revealed the appalling condition of a morgue located at the Quezon Medical Center in Lucena City. The graphic video showed a pile of dead bodies inside the morgue and even maggots coming out of a cadaver bag. According to the source, the video was taken last September 9 in the said morgue, which sold bodies of deceased patients due to COVID-19. According to the chief of hospital of Quezon Medical Center, there was an influx of COVID-19-related deaths in September, which led to the overcrowding of their morgue. The overcrowding was also attributed to the limited number of mortuary freezers and crematoriums in Quezon Province.
We were able to procure mortuary freezer at the start of the pandemic, dalawang butas yun. So yun yung capacity namin. But itong surge nga noong pagpasok ng September, in maximum yata is 15 to 17 cadavers yung maximum.
So walang paglalagay?
Hindi. Kaya yun yung nakita nila. I think noong nag-video sila ay nasa 12 yung cadavers na nandoon.
Dr. Rolando Padre has already appealed for the intervention of the Interior Department and local government units to solve the problem. According to the regulations of the government's Pandemic Response Task Force, deceased patients due to COVID-19 must be cremated within 12 hours after their death.
I'd like to stress na disposal of the remains no longer falls under the responsibilities of the hospital. As long as we provide the necessary documents, which are yung death certificate and the billing statement, that body is ready to go for pick-up. So ang naka-state dito sa memorandum is that pag meron mga ganyang mga bodies na tumatagal 6 hours to 12 hours, dapat yan ay DILG at saka yung local government unit ang gagalaw para ma-dispose nga, ma-bury siya or ma-cremate siya.
Meanwhile, the Department of Health's regional office in Calabarzon said they have already acted on the problem.
Pwede naman ibing, i-seal lang maigi. Sinisil siya sa body bag, tapos sinisil din yung ataul niya. And immediately, kailangan ilibing na. At even yung tomb niya, kahit na overground, hindi underground, ay sinisil na maigi.
The provincial government of Quezon also claimed it already acted on the problem and ensured the situation will not happen again.
Nagkaroon kami ng pile, ha? Totoo yun. Unusual yung dami ng namatay, hindi kaya ng crematorium, hindi rin kaya ng morgue. That's correct. I'm not going to deny that. We're trying to get a portable one, crematorium. Well, right now, controlled na. Wala na kaming mga bodies. Ang ginagawa lang namin, pina-wilting namin yung coffin. Dahil sa dapat, i-shield yun eh.
Dennis Datu, ABS-CBN News.
Over 190,000 doses of the Sputnik V vaccines are set to be delivered to the Philippines tonight. They will be used for second dose. Vaccine Chief Carlito Galvez Jr. says the Philippines is expected to get 1 million shots of the single dose Sputnik V Lite this month. Meanwhile, 660,000 AstraZeneca jabs arrived in the country on Friday. The latest shipment was procured by local government units and the private sector. Presidential Advisor on Entrepreneurship Joey Concepcion hopes fully vaccinated individuals would be given greater mobility to stimulate the economy.
Tayo na sa bahay, both vaccinated and unvaccinated, hindi gagalaw yung economy natin. At kung hindi gagalaw yung economy natin, paano natin bibilin mga bakuna, mga testing, mga equipment, mga medisina para sa mga tao natin?
For the month, 34 million vaccine doses are expected to arrive in the country. The Philippines has already administered over 40 million shots. That's ahead of the government's deadline set by the end of September. We're off to a quick break. Coming up, the U.S. military reveals 10 people were killed, including 7 children, during its drone strike in Kabul last month. Details when we return. Keep it here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Welcome back. A grim revelation from the U.S. military. General Frank McKenzie, the head of the U.S. Central Command, says 10 civilians, including 7 children, were killed in a U.S.-led drone strike in Kabul last month. The August 29 attack targeted Islamic State suicide bombers who posed an imminent threat to Kabul airport, where foreign forces were completing the last stages of their withdrawal from Afghanistan. McKenzie says the Pentagon was now considering preparations or reparations for the civilians killed.
I offer my profound condolences to the family and friends of those who were killed. This strike was taken in the earnest belief that it would prevent an imminent threat to our forces and the evacuees at the airport, but it was a mistake, and I offer my sincere apology. As the combatant commander, I am fully responsible for this strike and its tragic outcome.
Security is tight at the U.S. Capitol ahead of a rally dubbed Justice for J6. Hundreds of far-right demonstrators are expected in Washington for a rally on Saturday in support of the more than 600 people arrested on charges of joining the January 6 Capitol riot. Police warn there could be violence.
Tough to say whether they're credible or not. We don't know with any certainty. But what we do know is that the chatter that we heard prior to January 6th obviously turned out to be, many of those threats turned out to be, in fact, credible. And so we're not taking any chances. So what we're concerned about, I think, more than anything, is the possibility of counter demonstrators and making it to this demonstration and there being violence between those two groups.
Philippine Vice President Leni Robredo says she is ready to face off with former Senator Bongbong Marcos in the 2022 elections again, as she vowed to unite political forces against the administration. Marcos had claimed he believes he will win against Robredo this time, following his loss in the 2016 vice presidential race. Marcos is seeking to run for a national post next year. Robredo, for her part, says she is giving herself until the third or fourth week of this month to decide which post to seek.
Ako yung mapili ng unity ticket, tatakbo ako. Ako yun. Kung one-on-one na Bongbong Marcos, talalaban ako kahit dehado. Kahit sino kalaban, basta ako yung pipiliin ng anti-admin forces, laban ako. Yung pine-prevent ko lang naman na kami-kami maghihiwa-hiwalay.
Robredo also confirmed her plans to meet with Senator Manny Pacquiao and Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, who are potential candidates for president next year. Meanwhile, she claims 2022 presidential candidate Panfilo Lacson had closed off forming an alliance against the administration, quote, several times.
Handa akong lumaban kung yun yung kakailanganin, pero handa din ako mag-support ng somebody else. Kung sa last day, hindi ko ipiprevent yung sarili ko mag-exert ng effort. Mag-exert ng effort to seek out itong mga ibang pwede maging partners for 2022. May kasabihan nga, di ba? Habang may buhay, may pag-asa.
In other news, the Philippines Anti-Graft Court affirms its arrest warrant against former Customs Chief Nicanor Faildon in connection with a rice smuggling case. The Sandigan Bayan 5th Division denied for lack of merit Faildon's bid to dismiss the graft charges against him and to quash the arrest warrant issued last Friday. The Sandigan Bayan also maintained the bail it set for Faildon, which was 90,000 pesos for each of the two counts of graft. Faildon is accused of approving the release of two shipments of Vietnamese rice from the port of Cagayan de Oro in 2017 without the required import permit. The chairman of listed property developer DM Wenceslao and Associates Incorporated has passed away. Delfin Wenceslao Jr. was 77. Wenceslao took the company public in 2018, 38 years after his father established it in 1960. Aside from being a property developer, the company is also known as a specialist in land reclamation projects. Delfin Wenceslao Jr. was ranked 37th on Forbes' list of Philippines' richest in 2021, with an estimated net worth of $385 million. And those were the latest news at this hour. I'm Vivian Gulia. For feedback, you can email us at ancfeedback@abs-cbn.com. Keep it here on ANC.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.